If you feed me enough beer, then I will speak in German. But that's not a good combination, speaking a doing a presentation when you're drunk. So sorry, I will do it in English, but don't hesitate to ask me questions in German later. Okay. This is not too complicated talk, I hope. It's about my efforts to put all my development work into GitHub. Well, to use Git and use GitHub. I will tell you why I didn't do it before and what my hesitations are at the moment. And also I will demonstrate all the code you needed to get it to work. And that's at the end, even I did this for my own open source development work, but now I see even my practical professional purposes for this knowledge. I built this small project. So and, I started well, programming quite a long time ago, somewhere 2001 was the second European Pro Conference in Amsterdam. It was the first meeting which I visited, and I had to give Pro training, so I had to learn the language. It was my 30th language, and immediately I started programming modules and so on. So even in the first year I had some modules on CPAN already. And since then on, I release a few new modules every year. They have to maintain all those modules. So it grew to about 70 at the moment modules. And in the these 70 modules have seen about 1,100 releases together. So that's quite a lot. And that's it has a part of this so many releases is because I have a release often strategy. But that also makes a step going to release everything via Git or put everything in Git and put everything in GitHub a hard task, a task you cannot do with by hand. You have to write some small programs to help you. And I will show you how I did that. And maybe it helps you as well. Some of those modules are quite large, over 100 PM files. And so I don't like these very fragmented, small modules. I like to have libraries. For instance, I have an email library for email processing. And all the modules together are about 250 PM files. So that's quite a lot. And XML stuff and so on. Well, so if you look at search on CPAN, you see my list. This is a very old picture. It's about when I started, 2001. When I uploaded it, maybe I should change it a bit. One of the things I do not really like from this overview is that you have all these modules and it looks like one big mess. But it's not really a mess. I mean, most of those modules are related, or they are related to some of the tasks I have to do. Sometimes there are 10 modules which belong together. But if you look at the list, there are all kinds of weird things with email and geographic stuff and so on. You know, it's a bit messy. Maybe we could improve that in the future. Or maybe, are you using this one? Yeah, you prefer this one? Yeah, well, it's just a bit fancier, but the same information. So what's my idea of version control? Well, my version control is release often. I'm always a single developer, the only developer, and if I get two or three bug reports, I fix them and I make a new release. So that helps. It only works well when you are the only developer, of course. Then I always had a good memory, and I could just I think in the first 20 years of programming, I could remember nearly any sentence or any function which I wrote in my code. Just it's in that module and so on. But that has disappeared. Probably also to do with beer and whiskey, but I don't know. The other thing, what my experience is that patches you get are usually quite bad, and not always. I say 10% of the patches are really good enough to include directly, but in my experience, usually patches forget documentation, regression tests. They only fix the situation for the person who experiences an issue and breaks it for everyone else. And for instance, I never use Windows. I never test my modules on Windows. But if I get someone to help me with a Windows patch, it always breaks the Unix setup. So the whole idea of Git, where you have these forks and you just merge a fork and so on, I didn't see that happen, really. And that made me hesitate for version control systems where other people had access to my sources. There are also other complications. If you start in 2001 writing your code, you don't have Git, and you don't have all the modules you have on CPAN nowadays. And even internet was quite young. So I have my own release process, as all core Pro developers and all everyone who has many modules has some own scripts to support packaging stuff for CPAN and checking stuff for CPAN. And you have to rework that. I have my own documentation system I will show you. Also complications which I still have with Git. Maybe you can help me explaining it. But if you have, when I'm en route, I have a laptop with my Git stuff on it. And when I'm at home, I have a development server. And if I'm at the company, I have other things. And when you have larger changes which are not ready to commit yet, and how to work with that. That's a bit of a complication. I now have some ugly tricks, file copying and so on by hand to be able to work underway. But and people like to clone, but I don't like to clone. One of the if you are a module maintainer, you get all these very nice patches or requests for features. And often you want to refuse those features. But if you allow everyone to fork your code on GitHub, for instance, how can you restrict them? They want to add features which should not be in that module because it's very specific for a certain user, or it's, for instance, in the email modules, you don't want to have JSON decoding in email modules or something like that. And it's so when people write you an email for a feature request, you can negotiate, and then you say, okay, I will take it. But if it's on Git or GitHub, they just clone it and add it, and then you get the modules which go different ways and so on. So, okay, let me tell you a little bit about my documentation system, which I wrote somewhere in 2004 or so, and it was called OODoc, and that's a mistake. The main mistake is that after I made this module, someone released OpenOffice and called that OODoc and documents and so on. I should have called it OOPod, probably. It's an object-oriented form of documentation. And Perl 5 documentation system is very poor, I think. It's easy to document a single PM file, but it doesn't understand anything about object orientation and hierarchies. And it's only, you say, is item or is head to. But I want to have an abstraction. So I added a thin layer, which added things like is method and is section, which is just a head to, and is examples. So I added some syntax. And then before I release the software, it will be transformed into real pod. And it will understand hierarchies and so on. I will show you some examples. This saved me for my email modules about 70,000 lines of typing. In the beginning, in the first releases, I have about four levels of hierarchy in email modules, in object-oriented hierarchy. And if you add a new function somewhere down in the hierarchy, you have to copy that name in the documentation of higher levels. You may know all these IO file, IO handle modules, which list the methods which are inherited for lower levels and so on. And if you have to maintain it by hand, it's a lot of work. And my infrastructure helps me with that. I don't have to do that by hand. I'll show you. So this is a class method. Class method with the name and so on, and explanation. I added a link which is a bit more powerful than the standard L link. This can also link to separate option names inside methods or functions. It will automatically find out where the documentation is, in which manual page is the real documentation for this option, and so on. Here I have an option and defaults, and you can have overrule defaults on higher level in your hierarchy and so on in a simple way. So this is my usual way of documenting my code, interleaved. So this is documentation, and then a few lines of code, 50 lines of documentation, 2 lines of code, and something like that. And it produces things like this. So it produces automatically inheritance structure, and we format it. But it also produces, here you see a bit more detailed here, options on different levels of in the hierarchy are just grouped. So the same method name has more specific implementations, and it collects the options which are available on a certain level and in which level they are defined and the documentation of it and so on. And this is the pod which is generated during my release process. And it also produces real HTML, where you can go browse through the groups of methods alphabetically to all the manuals and so on, crisscross and so on. This is all, of course, 2005 style website, but it makes access much easier. Yeah. And that's why I also added this additional tag, the M tag, because in real HTML you can have much more specific links than you can do in a pod, in manual pages. Anyway, so I had some complications for my step. The release process, which is quite specific mine, and the documentation system, which is specific mine, how to work with these various locations where in all locations the code is halfway a commit, and I don't like people to clone that much. So, but the world is changing. So, release often. Release often. Once upon a time, I could do it with release often, but now I get this release every once in a while. And people want a fix, but a very small fix or a documentation patch. Debian is always feeding me with documentation patches. Do I really want to make a whole release to satisfy them, or is it just enough to push it on Git and then make the release later? Still people want to feed me patches. My memory has broken down a bit, and this is still an unsolvable issue. I have 17 years of garbage. I had to do something in the cleaning up licenses. My whole idea of how I should document my code or how I should structure the code and so on has changed over time. And I just standardized. This is about 2/3 of my modules, and as I had organized it then. And for instance, my email modules here, this was the 0 dot releases, and then I start with a copy, and then I for the next major release. And sometimes I have to go back to all the versions. Oh, this is maybe I like your disk, you know? Yeah, you get all these packages, and then you need a cleanup. And I abbreviated package names and so on. That is a mistake. Never start with short names because you get confused over the time. So let me see how I reorganized it. First, the release process. So this is my working directory, Perl, and then you saw the list of these. Mailbox 4 was in the list you saw on the previous page, and then you have such a file. On the moment I create a new release, I have a script. As everyone makes their own scripts, and it creates a temporary location where it copies all the files from the manifest to and extracts the pod files. The nice thing is that you can produce separate pod files for your PM file, so you can extract documentation from your PM file, which is then lighter to load, and you have separate pod files, and everyone understands that. So this is these are stripped PM files and nice real pod files. And then I package it. I make two packages, the raw package, which is my working set. And I'm very glad that I always kept them for the next step of this talk. The real release, which are real pod files. And I produce some HTML. Yeah. I put it also in my own public website, so pearlovermeer.net. And by hand, I upload it to Pulse, my stuff. In a new setup, so it's nearly the same, but I have a real nice long name. I don't need to keep old major versions anymore because it's all in Git, so I can go back and forth when I want to. I still have this release script because I still need to format the pods. Then you have to add Git directory and set this up and add a readme.md for GitHub markdown file. A little bit more complex, just one step more. I produce still the raw file, my working stuff, the release stuff. I upload it to CPAN. I async to my website, and some way or the other, I have to get it on GitHub. Okay, now have a look at GitHub. In the next talk will be about GitLab, which is probably much better. I don't know, but this is about GitHub. GitHub has understands that there is a big difference between software releases and for the developer's view and releases in the operations view. In the operations view, the operators, they want to know that the same version is on all systems. So that's a different concept of a release than just pushing some new thing to GitHub. To Git. So GitHub has also the concept of releases, and what they did is, just if you tag your Git version, then you can add some extra information and make it a release. So tags and release tables are nearly the same, the tags and the release list, but the release list has a way to add some assets. And what I want to achieve is, here's my version description from my changelog file, some additional packages which I released to CPAN. This is what I released to CPAN. These two are added by GitHub, which is that's the source, but that's the unprocessed source. That's the raw source with the raw version of my documentation. But that's automatically added. But I can add some my CPAN release as well in here. Now let's see how I do it. The first step was the one of the hardest. I spent the whole day just making a new web page for all my modules and reorganize them and have some administration, whether it's on GitHub already or not. That took me a whole day. And you see also that these modules, although there are over 60 modules on CPAN, that they are grouped. They belong together some way or the other. And then the script is something like this. We create a new directory. Yeah, Git should be in it. And then for each of my distributions, is this including this 5 extra minutes or not? Oh, okay. Then I will hurry up a bit more. I unpack the distribution, I commit them, I add the assets, so what you saw on the previous page, clean up. And finally, I prepare in the same directory everything else, my current working environment. I have a subdirectory for all bug reports that people gave me and so on. And that should never end up on Git. So somewhere at the last step, I have to get my whole environment back. Let's show you. There are two very nice modules in CPAN. One is the net GitHub package, and the other one is the Git repository. And I need them both. The version 3 of GitHub interface is a REST interface. And that's a nice abstraction. The version 4 is a GraphQL interface. GraphQL is far more flexible. You can ask all kinds of complex questions in one go. But the bad thing is that you need to add your own abstraction layer before you can use it, if you program it right. And the nice thing about the REST interface for version 3 is that the abstraction is already there. There are the REST commands. So I took the REST commands. You need to generate a long code on GitHub itself for your access. You started the code, you set your username and to start with. And then I just ask for whether the repository for my Perl module already exists. And if it doesn't exist, if you get an error message, it's always a string. And if it is, that's how this net GitHub module works. And if there's not an error message, you get a hash back. So if I get an error, then not found error, I create a new repository. As simple as this, just from your Perl program, client side, adding a new repository, four lines of code. The hash offers you a lot of URLs, how to interact with GitHub, which could change in the future and so on. So you should cleanly use these URLs. It's about 40 or 50 things which you get back when you open this repository. Then the second step, we have to start git in a directory. So I run this and the nice git repository module. Well, git repository mainly starts system for everything. It adds some small convenience layer between the system commands and your Perl program. Then I use archive tar to extract all the files from one of my releases. So I start with the first release, unpack it in the directory where I just started git. You run add all, everything from my release must be in. Then I find out the name of the changelog file, which is my timestamp of my release, because I'm sure that my changelog has changed every time. You have to be careful if you try things like that. The unpacking should use the original timestamps. That depends on your Linux configuration, whether it unpacks in local time or that you are allowed to have it in the original time, so 2003 and so on. Just so the first time you do it, you have to check whether it unpacks correctly. I get the date from this changelog file. I run a commit. And I tag it, so I because it was already released, so it is something that can be tagged in Git. And the intermediate steps are all lost to come to a new release. One of the weird things is that you can only set up a remote when you already have a commit. If there's no commit, you cannot set up the remote GitHub. Okay, and we run the push. From the changelog is just a file, so from the start on, I always use the same layout for my changelog files. So I just grab the text for a certain version, and then I create a release in the repository. So the create release, that's that specific GitHub thing for a release, and I have already a tag. From the previous step, I made a tag, and now I add release information around attack. And you can upload assets as simple as this. So add additional things to this the release. This is the release ID, the number, and then you get it's a pity that GitHub only understands zip archives and not tar archives yet. But you can specify it's a tar, but it cannot inspect it. Well, then we are getting close to the end. Yeah. If you move to GitHub, you have to add, they really want you to add a readme.md file, a markdown file with some things, how to install it and stuff. And the other thing where I had a lot of debate with our Justice Department, for where I work now and so on how should you document your license information? And it's very unclear. But finally, we decided that I had to add to all files I ever release a short statement where it belongs to. If you document where your PM file, to what project your PM file belongs, then it's enough because via the project you can find the license. You don't have to list the whole license in each of your files. So I had to add this. And the nice thing is, it works. So this is on GitHub. This is about one third of the way. I still have a lot of work to do. But I'm going back to 2008, for instance, and you see all my releases over the year. And in most places, you can trick GitHub in thinking that you made this release in 2003 already, although you uploaded it a week ago. So that's what I wanted to show you.